Tags? If you need to get me to use the mic, please tell me and I'll use it, okay? Alright. So
I think I better use the mic. Thank you, good morning. Thank you, Sujata. Thank you, Kenny. Thank you, Thai TESOL, for getting me over. The two places that I like to go to very often, they are two very comfortable. One is Thailand and the other is Indonesia. So you can see from my travel logs that I usually am in these two places. That's because, you know, I'm pretty laid back. And you can see in the progression that I've had. I have been a classical academic most of the time. And I tell you that that's very common in most universities, you know, especially in Asia, where your KPI depends on how many times you publish in Scopus journals or Hocus Pocus journals or whatever. And you know, these days you go to a job interview and people ask you, what's your H index? They don't ask you how old you are or how much you weigh. They ask you what your H index is. And for many of you who do not know what an H index is, well, welcome to academia, the academic world. It's a sad state of affairs. But I must tell you that I have been involved in textbook evaluation. Lately, many of my students have been working on corpus linguistics, on the language of textbooks. And that's interesting, but it is sometimes misdirected. You get a whole lot of information and data on how bad textbook language is, but never ideas as to how teachers can actually benefit from this research on the language of textbooks. So that's what I'm looking at. And so, I've run away from this madhouse and gone back to basic classroom teaching and nice little things like action research and how much this is beneficial to teachers. So, I'm now keen to run away from all the software programs that can help evaluate textbooks. I'm now very keen on getting teachers to understand what's wrong with our textbooks. People have been talking bad about textbooks for such a long time. The only people I think who have said positive things about textbooks are the people who write textbooks themselves. Jeremy Harper, for instance. David Newton, you know, because they make tons of money out of textbooks, which is good. Nobody should be envious or jealous of people who make money. But in our small little ways, we have to get teachers to understand that textbooks are artifacts. They're static. They are not going to direct teaching. The teacher directs teaching. And that's where I'm getting to the first point, that I need to make sure my timing is good so that I don't overstate. Maximizing learning, investment in learning. So I'm getting to this, and part of the reason why learner investment is not big is because people have always viewed the textbook as something more important than the teacher. And it has directed learning in most parts of the world, especially in second language and foreign language situations. It has also been a source of control. Teachers now believe that if they have a textbook, if students have a textbook, it's one way of controlling large classes. You come into a classroom and you want to start a lesson, and they are making noise, but you tell them, open your textbook to page 185. Absolute silence is one way of controlling a large class, or a mixed of each class, or whatever condition that there is in your classrooms. Are we really running out of ideas? In my country, I believe so, because large numbers of teachers these days do not even have the level of competencies that are good enough to get them to even teach, which means they are probably bad for the IELTS. Just that state of affairs. And because the shortage of English language teachers, people who are not trained to teach English have to teach. Another sad thing. So what happens is, okay, everybody is a buzz about technology. I still remember a friend of mine who runs a language school, and he tells me, I just hope I haven't chosen anything important. No, why is still there? So this language school operator can tell me, Jaya, is there any way in which I can minimize use of English language teachers and increase the amount of work students do on computers? I said, that's sad, isn't it? It's no longer viewed as self-access or extra resource. People want to bring this into classrooms. Have you noticed that the air conditioning is a bit too cold? I feel like I'm already in Washington, D.C. Okay, this is a good orientation for me. Next week, I'm going to Washington, D.C. Anyway, so they started something called the Teaching Courseware Project. And this Teaching Courseware Project, most people would say, well, it must be good. Because the moment you incorporate technology into classrooms, it must be good. It must be providing some form of assistance to teachers. Making classroom learning more productive, teaching more productive. But did it turn out that way? Most episodes of technology use do not turn out that way. And this was the basic premise from which they operated from before they came up with policy decisions, policy measures and decision making like this. They believe that technology can make ELT teacher proof. You've heard of idiot proof, haven't you? You know? If you have an appliance which is idiot proof, anybody can use it without getting burnt, getting electrocuted. So technology in this case, in our context, was supposed to be teacher-proof, which means teachers equals idiots. And they can do teaching with despite the fact that they have low proficiency levels in the English language, that they could sit in their classrooms and using this teaching courseware just by the press of the button, go slide by slide by slide by slide. Dangerous, don't you think so? Very dangerous. Why is it dangerous? Because this technology now is not just became a part of teaching, it became everything about teaching in classrooms. Teacher became lost in classrooms and played the role of courseware operator. So this wasn't a teacher, this wasn't a classroom, this wasn't teaching, this wasn't learning. It was a slideshow. It became a slideshow. In order to understand this, you have to go to websites saying Teaching Courseware in Malaysia and the Ministry of Education. I'm sure they have removed it by now because they have abandoned the entire Teaching Courseware project. Because every lesson had teaching courseware. Okay? Even the instructions that the teachers usually give, the computer gave. Slide one, listen to this conversation between. So what role has the teacher got to do in the classroom? Nothing. Press a button. The very essence of time-tested methodology that developed in ELT evaporated with this new technology. How are you, for instance, going to bring TPR into your classroom when you operate using slides? And you know, this is a warped view of how technology should be used in the classroom because it's neither interactive or anything else. It is a digitized version of a textbook. A digitized version of the textbook. And if this is supposed to be about the classrooms, God forbid. Okay? So, that was what inspired me now to look at how we can actually be a small part of the solution. You can never part with waters when it comes to ELT. Don't pretend you're Moses or somebody close to him. But you know, we can be small parts of the solution to this problem. The textbook exists now, and we have already lost everything that was invested in the technological teaching courseware. It's abandoned. Billions of ringgit spent on it. Now it's abandoned because people suddenly have come to realization that technology cannot direct learning and teaching. So, I have a simple research, actual research, and I tell my students, I say, look, instead of getting technology in its product form, how about using everyday technology to get students excited about the learning? Okay? This is what happened. I used technology as agent within the process. Technology is accessible. So handphones, that was the basic technology they used in this project-based learning that I carried out. Plus, they also used software which is free, like Movie Maker, okay? But let's look at a bit of background to the problem, because every action research needs a problem. This was a problem. This is a typical Malaysian textbook, and this is currently being used in our Malaysian schools. I must say that commercial textbooks have come a long way, but the problem with countries like us, which are extremely nationalistic, is because we believe that local industry has to prosper. And when local industry has to prosper, we leave out commercial publishers who have got years and years of experience developing textbooks. So we give local publishers, some of them fly by night, $2 companies developed overnight, and give them, make them bid for projects, and they do this with the expertise that is available. Usually the good teachers never write because they spend all their time teaching. And the people who write are the ones who probably do not teach well. So what happens is, I'm speaking for myself, look, I've never written a textbook in my life. You see? But because we don't have time to write these things. But never mind. This is a typical textbook. Look at the cliché introduction, family circle. Now, if you look, I've done some hardcore research on the use of vocabulary in textbooks. Corpus-based research I have now, if you want to use my corpus, I have now corpora of textbooks, many, many levels of corpora of textbook language. We are amazed to find that most of these textbooks don't even have the 3,000 essential words in the English language. They don't even have the 3,000 most frequently used words in the English language. And there you are, a textbook in Form 1, which is used for 13-year-olds in my country, has family circle. They look up the meaning of family circle in their bilingual dictionaries, and family means keluarga. Of course, if you're Indonesian, you probably can understand that. And circle means bulatan. Circle. And it's a totally different meaning. You see? So how dangerous it is now, at this level, there's not even proper management of vocabulary. excessive use of vocabulary with the entire patient's face is cluttered. But let us look at it from this angle. We're using the textbook like this. As a teacher, I found out from my students I involve my students in a lot of service, so they had to try this out in schools as well. And I asked my students, what do you think about starting a lesson with a textbook? Lesson one, using the textbook on family. Please look at that. Just the rubrics itself have actually increased the vocabulary load of that lesson to way beyond imagination. There is family circle. What's in store? What would you use if you were a textbook developer and if you had to give instructions? What would you use? Somebody call me up, please. I'm freezing. Yes. Actually, when people respond to you, that's when you feel a little better. Okay, I'm into it now. I'm in full gear, cruising speed. Come on.
You will learn.
You will learn. You look at that. And she, like myself, you're not writing textbooks, you're busy doing other things. Not to enrich ourselves, but look at that. What's your score? And it gives you all the objectives of the lesson there. Why do learners need objectives for this lesson? You tell me. Look at gear up. Gear up, what does it mean anyway? I have no clue. Gear up. Yes? Yes. Yes. You see? So, you see, we already have a problem. Okay. I want to ask you. What's the general service list? General service list was developed in the 30s, you know. How many words are there? 2,000 essential words in the English language. Of course, what happened is, Oxford? They have the Oxford 3,000 word list, right? Plan? Yeah? You used to sell books, my friend. Okay. Never mind. Okay, they have various word lists, which actually tell you about the most frequently words used in the English language. And the general service list, which was developed in the 30s, right? 2,000 words. That is the essential. And my research, and I've developed software to actually look at words, how they're used in textbooks over 5 years in the secondary curriculum. Hardly 40% of words in the general service list or the Oxford 3000 word list are in the closed textbook. Ignoring the essentials, the building blocks, the most frequently used words, and having idiomatic expressions all over the place, total mismanagement of textbook writing. Commercial textbooks have the same problems, I tell you, because I have worked on them. It's because getting permission to get them developed, put into a corpus is a horrible thing. You know, you can never get permissions from commercial publishers. But local publishers do not know what we're doing with these things. So they usually allow us, not knowing how much of that is going to cost the reputation. Because, you know, the essential words are not there, the wrong words are not, things like that. But look at this. 1978. Some of you were not born that year. But I was, I think, in the first few years of teaching. But I tell you this, it's 1978, Matson and Bowen, two American researchers said that apart from textbooks being a total disaster, they have contributed to the lack of, number one, situational realism, number two, linguistic realism. John meets Mary at the airport, and John says, "Hello, Mary, where have you come from?" Mary says, "From New York." "Oh, have you been to Los Angeles?" "Yes, I have." Have you been to Cairo? Yes, I have. Have you been to Kuala Lumpur? Yes, I have. Have you been to Mozambique? Yes, I have. This was supposed to teach the affirmative. But that is the point that Maxim and Bowen are trying to say. Linguistic realism is not from textbooks. But more important is the fact that situational realism is also lost in textbooks. These are books for 13-year-olds, young adults, and you have people, the textbook writer, asking a definition of what a family is. Do we really need to know a definition about families? And what fact people in families, how they are, a family is a group of people who are related to one another, live together, yes, most of the time, love one another most of the time, hopefully, do things together, 13-year-old kids, do things together. You know, that's the sad part about families. I know many of you are saying, well, there is a reason why textbooks are developed that way, and that's because textbooks are media for government agendas as well. How to see moral values into society at a young age, things like that. Very important too. There are three textbooks in the Malaysian system because there are three zones. And this contractor has a textbook called, which starts off with family ties and 13-year-olds helping their parents in the kitchen, preparing lunch, having lunch together, playing frisbee in the park, not a game that Malaysians play, but you know, you're learning the language of native speakers of English, so better bring the frisbee in. You have skateboards that you put too. And then they're all watching TV together, not having arguments like, excuse me, I'd like to watch Glee, if you don't mind. And the father says, excuse me, you're 13 years old, you shouldn't be watching Glee. The mom says, you know, she wants to watch a MasterChef, and dad wants to watch football, there's no arguments. There's a perfect life. In families engineered for the occasion. The occasion is the classroom. Sadly, that's why English language doesn't make much progress. And so, this is action research, and I tell my kids, what are you going to do if you're going to go into class and you're having a good laugh about these textbooks? I must tell you, however, that despite the fact that government textbooks are produced this way, there's not much of a hope for an alternative, because this American textbook, for instance, is just like that. Except that it comes with a cleaner sheet of paper. There's a lot of white space, which is very important for kids at this stage not to be, you know, looking at pages cluttered with information. And it's still boring. So what do you think we should do? What do you think we should do? I said, okay, what would you do? You have a problem here. So I said, Chala, it's time for my problem. How much time? Great, thank you. Give me a 5-minute holler, okay? 10 and 5, thank you. So you know what? I brainstormed with my students and I said, look, if you think this is ugly, how are you going to make this pretty? And they said, okay, good, sir. Let's talk about bringing classrooms, photographs from home. And I tell you, I set a task to them. Okay, good. Tomorrow you go back. You bring 10 photographs that can tell a wonderful story about your family. And they all go, oh! I said, come on, only 10 photographs. But you know, this is a task I had set myself when I was 18. You know why it's difficult for them? The challenge of selection. They have 2 million photographs in their data banks. Unlike our time, we had hard copies of photographs. So photographs of mom and dad when they first arrived from India and worked in the plantation. And the story of a sister who died on the way back to India from the interior. I could tell a nice story. So when I brought my photographs, my students were excited. And I said, you know, because I said, if you bring your photograph and tell about your story first, you are providing the scaffolds for them to use when they tell their own stories. You are, because you are the model, you see. There are some bits of methodology. If you go to that US Embassy booth and purchase those dialogue Freeman tapes, which I swear by until today, you will get the idea that even providing scaffolding is important in classrooms that you teach. Not in first language situation, of course in second and foreign language situations, scaffolds are important. The teacher is supposed to be a model. That's why teaching courseware went dead. Because the teacher was never a model in those classrooms. There were no scaffolds provided. So you come up with your own stories. And for heaven's sake, English language teaching is all about stories. If you get them into the story mode, the language learning gets to be faster. So you come up with this story and say, this is what happened, this is my mom and dad. And of course now you can transfer all those into the computer and show them on the OHP projector. This is where they first arrived, they only had one suitcase, and that's a wonderful story, isn't it? After they finished, they get in their groups, and they, with their 10 photographs, tell each other in groups of 5, their own family stories, and then each group selects one very good story to tell the whole class, and that's how the thing goes. But what happens after that? We never touch the textbook. We threw it out of the window. This was Shi Huang Ti. Great visitor. Remember he burnt all Confucius' books? Yes. I'm sure some of them hate some of them. That's why we still know about Confucius. See? But Shi Huang Ti burnt all those books. And we need to just do the same in the textbooks that are bad. How do you go about doing this? Task development is very important. I told you, when I say 10 photographs that tell a story for the family, you want to say, it's impossible, sir. I say, okay, why? You got a million of it or so. Yeah? That was the most challenging aspect of the task. Not about doing it, it's about decision making. It's about challenges that you have. It's about risk taking. If I throw out this one photograph, will it affect my story? Those were the things that were important in the task. Stuff was all there. And, of course, I give a project-based learning task later where they had to do a 1 minute video of the family. Now, remember those stories of engineered families in textbooks? You saw that on the textbook pages? You look at the products that I've had. I'm not going to show you everything. I will show you the happy ones. Because you see, those happy families in the textbooks, right? I've got nothing against happy families, I tell you. And some of those kids came out real happy families, and I told them they had to insert a song in there, and with what made the task more interesting and challenging was they had to find the appropriate song to accompany their movies, the videos. 1 minute videos, which actually teaches them discipline, that you have to work within the task 1 minute, helps them develop discipline to tell you that, you know, they are confined to tasks and they have to get used to it. So, they went back. Alright? And this is the part time that I show you. I tell you, I've got lots of happy movies and kids who are happy. Most of the others never looked at the videos very much. The ones that were looked at, if I can find my file, yes, here. Okay. There was this wonderful lady called Ruth Weinberg. You have heard of Ruth Weinberg? Australian. She wrote a wonderful article called Death, Taxes, and Jeopardy. Systematic omission of all three in textbooks. Nobody dies in textbooks. And I wonder who came up with the notional functional syllabus. And in the notional functional syllabus, there's a function called to convey condolences. How do you do that when you don't have anybody dying in a textbook? I still remember being, a friend of mine told me that he was in his office and the PA boss said, as his friend came and says, is so-and-so in the office? He just passed away. She actually managed, he just passed this way. And the PA said, he just passed away. And I said, oh my God, I just opened him this morning. But you see, the thing is, you can start. Malaysian students can go and study in the US, and God forbid, if somebody died, they wouldn't have a clue as to what to say. You know? They probably say, or did they? Or did he? Or did she? And trying to figure out a translation in Bahasa Melayu is quite difficult because they actually say it in Arabic. How are you going to say it? You don't even teach that, oh, I'm so sorry, yes, or things like that, which is so simple. But because it's totally omitted, as Ruth Weinberg says, systematic omission of these things in textbooks. So we have very unreal situations. But look at this. In our textbooks, no divorce, no single parent families, no nothing. Know that. You give them project-based learning, this is what happens.
Worth considering.
Some people, not just from English, but in the field of psychology, for instance, should be looking at this and saying, my God, look at that. This is a great way that would change the way we teach. In a small way, very small way. And look at what it's doing. We get to know the kids better because of their old families, the textbook family. Things like that. Right? One more. Yes, nobody is supposed to get diseased in textbooks. So, this one.
Thank you.
Many of people dialect, you know? So that's what it is. I believe that project-based learning has hope, and it really think that there are constraints. Yes, but in my case, I found that, you know, the constraints are minimal, and that it's workable because you spend things like 2 hours on technology. It is, I mean, editing takes some time, but technology use and
thank you very much. Do we have time for any questions on the floor? Any questions, any comments? If not, may I call upon Mr. Professor Shadan Mani to present a token of appreciation to Professor Jaya. I have some announcements for Thai teachers who have received a grant from RELO. Please meet Professor Kubon at Pioneer Room 7 on the second floor at 11:30. Okay, สำหรับคุณครูไทยนะครับ